Welcome to Barnard Castle School. I'm Frank McNamara, the present headmaster, and as such, also president of the Old Barnardians Club, which was founded in 1895, 12 years after the founding of the school. One way chosen to celebrate the centenary of the club was to make a new presentation of the school film, first shown in 1949. Created by enthusiastic amateurs, all full-time members of the teaching staff, the film was originally a silent film, but commentary has now been added by Alan Wilkinson, himself a former member of staff and Old Barnardian. The Old Barnardian Centenary Committee very much hopes that this film will be of interest to all generations of Barnardians, and particularly to those who were at school in the 1940s and 50s.
The school's badge consists of two linked shields, commemorating John Balliol on the left and Benjamin Flanders. Part of the estate of each of them was directed towards founding the school. The motto can be translated as, "Having mastered minor matters, you can safely attempt greater ones." Barnard Castle School is situated in the northeast of England, and for the first 40 years of its existence, its name was the Northeastern County School. As soon as it was built, this castle became known as Barnard's Castle, and the town which grew up beside it was Barnard Castle. The River Tees, which flows past the fortress, rises high in the Pennines and forms the southern boundary of the ancient market town. The river has some gently rippling stretches, but for the most part it flows swiftly and is said to be the second fastest river in England. Soon after leaving the town, the river accelerates into rapids as it nears the 18th century Abbey Bridge, where people crossing it once had to pay a fee at the toll house. Almost midway between the castle and this bridge, on the side of the valley, stands Barnard Castle School. It acquired its present name in 1924. The white cupola, traditionally known as the pepper pot, rises above the rest of the building, on the front of which is a carved record of the laying of the school's foundation stone on the 6th of November, 1883. Now, in 1948, please come in. At the beginning of each term, porters, gardeners, and other employees of the school carry boarders' luggage through the front door and into the central hall. An old clock announces the start of each new day. A monitor checks the time by his own clock and arouses the dormitory. Down they go, clattering on the hollow wooden steps of the spiral staircases on their way into the dining hall. There's always one with his own ideas of time. But down he goes too, and nervously eyes Mr. Beetham, who checks the exact time on his pocket watch and rings the bell, which gives the signal to start breakfast. Every school day begins with morning chapel. This window is a First World War memorial, and the picture below is entitled Christ the Consoler. The pews face each other to emphasize the spirit of a close-knit community. As the boys file in, Mr. Haywood plays a voluntary on the organ. The headmaster, Mr. H.E. Birkbeck, follows the school into the chapel. Up for a hymn. Down for a reading. Up before kneeling for prayers. And finally up again before filing out into the morning sunshine. This organ was installed in 1921. Mr. Birkbeck was appointed headmaster in 1935, when there were only 193 boys in the school. In 1942, he was elected to the headmaster's conference, which gave the school official recognition as a public school. Under his guidance, numbers increased until in 1948, there are 258 boarders and 96 day boys. The pupils, having assembled together in chapel, now divide into their various classes. Mr. Rowell takes a lesson in geometry, with a little help from others. Mr. F. Ferguson plays with a flourish for a singing lesson in big school. Mr. D.F. Pittuck takes a class into the Bowes Museum Park for art in the open air. Mr. Southwood gives last-minute instructions at the end of an English lesson. Mid-morning break is the time for physical exercise, supervised by Colour Sergeant R. Davis, though he was always referred to as Sergeant Major. He kept his military bearing long into his retirement. Back into class. Magazines from France help with learning the language. Next door, tadpoles from a neighbouring pond have been brought in to help with biology. Topic after topic is dealt with, lesson after lesson. A fascinating part of the biology class is the dissecting. At quite an advanced level, though with no external examination in mind in those days.
Polymerizes.
Chemistry and physics are taught for school certificate and higher school certificate. And all the time, everyone is summoned by bells.
By the knowledge it possesses. So, very clearly, we need to get the knowledge. And to get the knowledge, we need to understand what knowledge is.
Mr. Musgrove enthusiastically gives a history lesson to a responsive class. As the day wears on, however, one boy begins to find it all too much.
I'm going to look at a topic area to run through for you.
Life becomes a blur. It's fourth lesson, but dinner seems a long way off. The subject of a dream. Behind the scenes, what preparations go on to provide the school meals? The theory here and the potatoes here. Thousands upon thousands of them. Every week, every month, every term. Basting the meat meanwhile at the scrubbed wooden tables. Stirring the unidentifiable, rice pudding perhaps. And there are those potatoes again, followed by hard physical labor, finishing touches, and more dissection. Back in the classroom, the dream fades into the reality. The rattling plate reflects the sound of the bell. It was very interesting, sir. The dining hall looks smart and inviting under the gaze of past headmasters on the far wall. On the left, Mr. Prest, on the right, Mr. Brierton, and here, Major Coombs. The present headmaster, Mr. Birkbeck, says grace. The outdoors call, but work must be done. Among its many functions, Big School was the library, and sometimes a peaceful place for private study. It was also used for examinations. The tests in spoken French were conducted in privacy away from the other candidates. Not in the usual sense, Founders' Day, but the day on which the foundation stone was laid. The staff file in for speech day. Messrs. Southwood, Snodgrass, Fender, Goldsmith, Rowell, Ferguson, and Hardesty. Professor Birchnell is the chairman. Various courses have been used for the Barnard Run. This one began just in front of the school and then went over the boundary wall, a practice that was later frowned upon as too dangerous so early in the run. The runners spread out over the open countryside. Spectators wait at the finishing line. Some runners are in Green Lane. People look up at the top of the long field for the first runners to appear. Other competitors are still running down the fields from the Darlington Road to the Green Lane. The easiest part of the course comes last. The finish is along level ground. Mr. Hardesty records times and placings. And announces the results of the annual event. Rugby matches are much more frequent. The left wing, Kenneth King, tackles, inaugurates a move, nearly scores, and then, like all wingers, spends some time waiting for the next incident in which he can be involved. In later years, Kenneth King became a member of staff and was honorary secretary of the Old Barnardians Club for 30 years. And here, Kenneth King scores. Two matches from a highly successful season are combined in this part of the film. One was against Archbishop Holgate's and one against Pocklington. Winter brings the beauty of frost to the school's peaceful surroundings. Winter also brings the nuisance of frost and fog for the match against Durham School. It was the final home match of the season in which the first 15 won all its matches against other schools. Though their main activity was rock climbing, members of the Goldsborough Club ranged widely in Teesdale. Here they are at Cronkley Fell. Here looking downstream towards Holwick Fell, and here studying ornithology. But this is home territory, Goldsborough, an excellent practice ground for climbing. Led by Mr. Beetham, a very experienced climber who had been a member of the 1924 Everest expedition. He encouraged and he led by example. From a high point above, Mr. Kynaston films proceedings. Blakey, in a military beret, home from the war, also gains the summit. The headmaster continues his review of the year's activities. Energy, as well as orderliness, in the wide open spaces. The chief scout, Lord Rowallan, meets Miss Kathleen Allison of the prep school and her charges. Equipment and boys are off for a weekend camp at Raygill. Only 2 miles away, but foreign territory for some young members. Another example of how the school uses the wonderful countryside which surrounds it. Patriotic ceremony is followed by outdoor worship. The open air has given everyone a healthy appetite. Back at school, an important engagement is fulfilled by Lord Barnard. Riding along on The commanding officer of the JTC is the bursar, Major E.S. Shepherd, who with the headmaster accompanies the visiting inspecting officer. Military music for the march past is provided by a regimental band from a permanent camp nearby. To illustrate tactical exercises and manoeuvres, the film editors have combined shooting on the Deepdale range with an assault on the school buildings. The visiting officer seems well satisfied. Built in the previous century, the swimming bath was in need of renovation as it neared its 50th anniversary. A lesson for juniors is being taken by Mr. John Parry. He encourages a beginner and then turns his attention to the senior class. Diving for bricks, as they were called, though really made of weighted blocks of wood, taught boys to be efficient underwater swimmers, part of their work for a life-saving certificate. Rescue work was taught first on dry land, as a form of drill, and only when this was mastered did more realistic training take place. Mr. Brereton was the school's first headmaster. During his 23 years at the school, Mr. Parry raised swimming to a very high standard. Under his direction, the school team several times won the public school freestyle relays for the Bath Club Cup and the medley relays for the Otter Cup. The bursar was apparently happy to join his staff in some of their tasks. Here also is the groundsman, Mr. Frank Brasher, followed by the assistant bursar, Mr. Haywood. Boy labour was always welcome. Part of the town is visible behind the concrete practice wickets, but junior games are played in rural surroundings. The first 11 practice in more cultivated areas of the field. On the left, Mr. H.D. Badger is resplendent in Oxford Authentics blazer and white flannels, while guests and vehicles assemble. John Atkinson leads out the old boys, and Hicks and Allinson open for the school. Members of the production team, think hard. Despair. Use their imagination and individually pluck ideas from thin air. They knock them together and pool them for future discussion. Cameraman becomes more frenetic. Editing is exacting work, and splicing requires patience. It is only filming in reverse that makes the operation look easy. Every boy could win points for his house by achieving a standard that was appropriate to his age group. These events took hours and hours to complete, so they took place during the weeks leading up to the actual sports day. Mr. Snodgrass announces the events. The recorders are Dr. H.C. Woods on the left and Mr. N.P. Lewis on the right. The man under the hat was Mr. E.W. Boxall of the Darlington and Stockton Times. Mr. Hardy officiated with the starting gun, which was sometimes the false starting gun, and Mr. Beetham officiated again with watch in hand. Thank you. didn't often see a member of staff sitting down, but Mr. Beetham is checking for footfalls. Mrs. King, mother of the head boy, presented the prizes. Victor Ludorum received a trophy and was crowned with a laurel wreath. Some of the features originally planned for the chapel had not been completed, hence the projecting stones ready to key into the porch, which has since been added. The Bishop of Durham dedicated the war memorial. The panelling of the chapel was completed, and the names of old Barnardians who were killed in the Second World War were added to those already recorded as having died in the 1914 to 18 war. The dining hall was also refurnished as part of the 1939-45 war memorial. Mrs. Birkbeck and her daughter Mary lead the congregation out of the chapel. The governors meet. Colonel W.I. Watson, clerk, hands the minute book to Professor A.L. Mellenby, chairman, who is about to address the governors. Plans to extend the school buildings are discussed. The architect prepares a report, and a survey is carried out. Prefabricated classrooms, known as the prefabs, were erected and exceeded their expected lifetime, incidentally shortening the boundary of the main cricket square for over 20 years. They became, however, a valuable addition to the existing classrooms and laboratories. The prep school was run at this time by Mr. and Mrs. Charles Hardy. It had its own spacious grounds, and gardeners worked in the potting shed, which the filmmakers saw as a symbol of the prep school itself. There were two girls among the pupils. Both were daughters of members of staff. Their fathers were Mr. Birkbeck, the headmaster, and Mr. Whiteley, the art master. Miss Gwyneth Coutts was the teacher of this class. The boys had their own garden, and playing on the mound in the playground became an abiding memory for former pupils of the prep school. And finally, scenes that have vanished into history. Departures from Barnard Castle Station on the London and North Eastern Network. The Darlington train from one side of the platform, followed by the Bishop Auckland train on the other, conveyed members of the school to stations throughout the North Eastern counties. Not only the railways, but time itself, like an ever-rolling stream, bears all its sons away. The story ends as it began, with the River Tees flowing down to Barnard Castle.
Well, that was Barney in the 1940s. Let's take a look at it 50 years on.
The day still starts with morning chapel. Here the headmaster, Mr. Frank McNamara, follows both pupils and staff into the daily service. Here come the inevitable stragglers. After a short service of hymns and prayers, everyone is ready to take their place in the school timetable. This is the library, completed in 1962 on the site of the chapel lawn. Through the library window, we have a brief glimpse of the chapel porch, which was finally completed a year later in 1963. These artists are working in the spacious modern art rooms situated on the site of the old gym, which once doubled as the groundsman's shed and the cricket pavilion. The pond is an extension of the biology lab, which came into existence by means of a bequest from Benthley Beetham, who taught biology from 1914 until 1949. With science buildings on three sides, the quadrangle terminates on the south side with the language classrooms. All were built at varying dates between 1951 and 1982 on the site of the former kitchen garden. This fine model is a reminder of Barney's once bustling station, sadly gone forever. But I am quite sure a fond memory for some older old Barnardians. The swimming pool, whilst unchanged in size, has been completely refurbished from roof to coloured tiles. The prep school still exists very much as it was. Indeed, some of the games have continued just as they were. However, certain changes have taken place to upgrade the dormitories and the need for extra classroom facilities, here seen at the back of the mound. Talking of changes, this next item should be of great interest to many older old Barnardians.
This is the residence of all the boarding girls at Barney. Welcome to Longfield House.
Barney introduced girls to the sixth form in 1981, shortly after which girl boarders were accommodated in this newly built Longfield House. Most of the girls have single rooms with fine views across Teesdale. The day girls are also well looked after in their own Marwood House, once the isolation hospital, now a scene of peaceful study. At least it was when we called. And now for a spot of physical activity, the sports hall. Custom built in 1974 at the top of the kitchen garden behind the old stone bike shed, it caters for practically all forms of exercise and is a tremendous help when the weather prevents outside activities. Inter-house competition still exists. Here we see one of the three teams involved in a house match. The dining room, where substantial change has taken place. No longer the entire three houses sitting at once, but self-service at varying times to accommodate both boarder and day pupil. A choice of starter, main course and suite is certainly a far cry from when this lad carried in his cornflakes, axle grease and marmalade. Members of the combined cadet force prepare prior to setting off for some rifle practice at the Battle Hill Range near Lartington. Well, that's a brief sample of Barney as it is in the 1990s. If you haven't been back for a while, why not get in touch? We in the Old Barnardian Club, we'd love to see you again.